Hello, hello, Social Media Breakfast. Welcome, welcome again for another episode of Social Media Breakfast live stream. I have with me today here Mike Italia. Hi, Mike.
Good morning.
How are you doing?
Good. How are you?
I forgot to tell you, you can bring your coffee. I forgot to tell you that part.
I have water for some reason.
Oh, water. Well, this is actually chai tea, so I'm sort of...
Okay, there you go.
But there you go. So cool. So welcome, welcome. And as you guys come in, make sure you tell us you're here in the comments so we know you're here. No, wait, it's Mike. Okay, say yes, Mr. Pickle Juice. Yes, we have
pickle.
Mike. It is actually a real person most of the time. Not always. So Mike is the head of the Digital Hive, and we're going to talk about what the Digital Hive is here in a minute. It's an in-house social media and digital content studio at Mars Wrigley. He oversees social media, influencer, and digital content strategies for North America. And I'm really excited to have you here. Hi, Mike. How's your morning going? Tell us where you're at.
So we're right outside New York City. So Mars is based in, we just have a new, beautiful new office in Newark, New Jersey, which is about 8 miles outside New York City. And it's funny because they built us this beautiful studio for content production about 2 years ago. So we were there for about a week before everything kind of fell apart. So we have this beautiful space out there that someday we're going to get back to and start, you know, using it. But right now we're shooting a lot of content out of our apartments and homes.
I've been noticing that. Like, I saw one with like empty cupboards.
The same kitchens over and over again.
The hearth, you know, that kind of
yep.
stuff around Christmas. Yeah. Yeah. So, tell us a little bit about Mars. I mean, Mars is like a bigger company. Mars Wrigley is a bigger company than maybe you would imagine. You guys do. I was shocked when I went onto the website. All of the brands that you do, and in fact, I'm going to pull up the share page here while you talk about it. But
yeah. So Mars Wrigley, part of Mars Inc. So Mars Inc., our parent company, obviously Mars Wrigley is a good portion of that. All of our Mars chocolate, fruity confection, gum brands, Orbit, Extra, Five Gum are the big gum brands you have right here, actually. So, and then from a chocolate perspective, obviously M&M's is our flagship brand, followed closely by Snickers, Twix, Milky Way, Three Musketeers. And then in our fruity confection side, we have the big players are Skittles and Starburst. And then there's a lot of smaller brands you see here. There you go. Skittles right there. Skittles Wildberry. A lot of smaller gum brands. Maltesers is a big brand out in the UK. Obviously, we're a global company, so some of our brands are more regional. Dove Chocolate, for example, is a big brand here in the US, but overseas it's called Galaxy. So we have similar brands, sometimes slightly different names, slightly different positioning some places. And then that all rolls up to Mars Inc., which, Mars Inc. is also a much larger company from a pet food perspective. So we have a lot of pet brands. Pet care. Yeah. So we actually own a Banfield Hospital. So a lot of pet facilities across the US. We're very big on pet care and pet health.
Yeah. I thought that was great. So one of the things I did in getting ready for this interview is actually really going through your website, going through some stuff. I actually listened to some podcasts and stuff of other people, but you guys have, it's interesting to me, but the company is actually family owned. So it's not a publicly traded company.
It is not. Now we're one of the largest family owned companies.
Yeah. So that actually gives you some interesting flexibility according to what I've heard of, like, I was listening to maybe your boss. I don't know. Yeah. So,
yeah. One of our principles actually is freedom. And I think, being family owned, we have the freedom to kind of run our business, do what we think is the right thing to do. So, you'll see us make longer term investment decisions that if we are a public company, we might not be able to do. We're not answering to Wall Street, we're answering to the Mars family. And, we can invest in their passions and take things further and have more of a longer term vision versus just a calendar 12-month year vision sometimes.
Yeah. So what I did is I did a little scavenger hunt around my house. After I went over the website, I was like, ooh, I have that. I have a couple of things I didn't know were even like Mars brands. So what I want to do today, guys, is that you're in your houses. So I think let's play a game. So like, if you can walk around your house and find as many Mars brands as you have, take a picture of yourself with your Mars brands. Just like this. Oh wait, other way, like this. And I'm going to show you what I have. So I've got Kind bars. So you guys do Kind bars? Yeah.
Yep. Absolutely.
These actually, we sent these out in care packages for our Gift of Guidance program we just did in December. We do a social media strategy sessions with nonprofits. We this group, this amazing group you're seeing kind of jump in here in the comments, they sit around with the nonprofits and they come up with a strategy for them, a social strategy
or digital
for the year. So we sent these out as part of that. Okay, this is my favorite gum. Right. So I did not know this was a
Orbit Light.
Mars Wrigley brand. So Orbit, and I just got a new package. You can see this just came in Amazon.com. So
there you go.
That's that. And then this was a funny one. So this came in my stocking this year, but I love Skittles.
Skittles.
Yeah. Well, actually I also had Snickers Christmas trees, but they didn't actually make it to this. They didn't make it to this.
That happens.
And the Skittles almost didn't make it either. As I pulled them out, I told you my youngest son said, "Mom, can I have those?" I'm like, "No, they're going on a live stream. You can't." So those are what I have. So if you guys like find some Mars Wrigley brands around the house today, take a picture of yourself with them, and then tag them SMBHOU, which is our hashtag. And we will we'll interact with you. And if you can find for extra credit, if you can find the social handle for that brand and put it on there, Mike will say hi to you as well.
You might get a response from the brands, absolutely,
or from whomever, from your team. Your team will respond.
My team. It's not just Mike. Mike has a whole team of people back in the office or home.
So Mike's team will respond. And we'll talk about that in a minute, about how you run your team, like what it is and all of that. But I just wanted to have a little fun game. So if you guys do that, make sure you do that. And I told you there was a wall of all of their brands, and I'll show you that again. I will actually put this as a link in the stream. Hold on just a second while I grab the link, the link, and I'll put it in here. But what I love about this wall that's created on the website is that, you know, if you have multiple brands that you have to put on a website, that is always such a huge challenge. Even if it's like business brands, right? So say you have like your main, like for me, let's just say me, for example, because I'm having this problem. I have an agency, right? So we've got the agency, and then we've got Social Media Breakfast, and then we have Smart Social Secrets. And so it's like, how do you put all of those into one website? So I thought your web team did a great job with this, but it's a wall of brands. And all you have to do is click on each brand, and underneath it, it tells you where they are on social media. And all you have to do is click on that, and it takes you to the brand page. I love this. Have you guys like grabbed all of these like Altoids? Do you also have Altoids on Twitter somewhere so you don't lose it?
We do. So most of our brands, we have, you know, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter kind of reserved. Most of our brands are active, but some of the smaller brands, for example, Hubba Bubba, for example, is a smaller gum brand. We reserved a TikTok channel, Twitter channel. But just reserving it still makes it public facing. So our fans can still tag us. We can still be part of conversations. Even if there's not an active team in place managing Hubba Bubba every day, I still get notifications. So-and-so tagged us. In fact, just this week, we were tagged on TikTok. One of our influencer friends is trying to create the world's largest ball of gum. And they started tagging Hubba, "Hey, tag Hubba Bubba. Maybe they'll send us some gum. We can help us build this thing." And, you know, we have like 8,000 followers in the course of a day, just because he was actively tagging us, looking for some product and some sponsorships. And now we're going to send gum, obviously, but yeah, there's always content out there. People are always pulling our brands onto social, whether or not we want them to, whether or not we're even present for that brand. Sometimes it's extremely funny. Sometimes you're like, "Ooh, maybe that's interesting." So you get a lot of interesting and very creative, amazing stuff. People tag us in and create with our brands, even if they're not actively present every day on social.
That actually was going to be some of our questioning, so I'm going to just jump into that with you.
Yeah.
So let's talk about that, because I think co-creating with your community is a really cool thing. And you especially, I believe you especially and your team do this extremely well. Like, I feel like that's why I asked you here, because I feel like this is something that you do like extremely well, is this co-creation with your community. Could you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I would say our best performing content, especially our best performing organic content, almost always comes from the fans, or the insights come from our fans and our followers. When you look at, you know, what we're trying to do in the organic space, is you got to push content that people want to interact with. You know, from a paid perspective, we're putting money behind that content. It's going out to everyone. So I'm less concerned about how engaging the paid content is, because you're going to see it. You know, it's an ad. But when we're trying to build these engaged communities, you got to interact with them in ways that they want to be interacted with. And you have to make sure the content you're putting out doesn't come across like an ad. The last thing I want to do on my Facebook or Instagram or Twitter feed is just see another ad from another brand. So we try to make sure that the content resonates with them. And we do that simply by engaging with them, talking to them, listening to them. Some of our brands, you know, we have active chat rooms on Twitter, group chats on Twitter that are always jumping in and talking to our fans. Some of our brands have Discord servers where we're just like there talking to 8,000 people at once, just, you know, learning from them. I mean, I've learned so much in the last 3 years of doing this role just simply by talking to, you know, the 15 to 25 year olds that are like primarily in our Discord server, learning the language, learning what's cool, what's not cool. I mean, imagine trying to do this, you know, without that insight, you'd come across like, don't talk to me. You don't know what you're talking about. But I think we've been able to have more authentic conversations just simply by listening and learning from them all.
Yeah, no, I mean, that was one of the things that really stood out to me, because I do also have, I have teens. So one of the things I find really interesting is that they, this Discord is like so big for them right now. It's definitely the way that they connect with their friends and talk these days. So the way, just the way you and I, maybe in our, my age range, like in below, you know, this age range on Twitter might talk, they talk on Discord. So could you talk a little bit about that?
It's the most fascinating thing that we've ever been involved in, I think, in the last 3 years. So it started as a it started with Skittles, and Skittles was engaging with fans and followers in group chats. And you know, we get pulled in every couple of minutes. Someone's pulling us into a group chat on Twitter, and we can't obviously engage with everyone. But we started actually engaging in some of these group chats. And the limitation there is, you know, 30, 40, 50 people at most can actually be a part of this conversation. Mm-hmm. And some of our fans in that group chat actually said, hey, why don't you go on Discord? You can talk to as many people as you want in one massive group chat. I see Pickle talking. He's one of our Discord or Twitter followers. So, I mean, we went to Discord and said, okay, let's see if we can have a much larger conversation. It started at, you know, a small 100, 200 people, and it grew very quickly. You know, we tweet the link out a few times to the Skittles Discord server, and now we have about 8,000, 9,000 people just in this massive server. You know, and it's kind of has its own hierarchy now. We have a staff within the server. You know, we have a manager. Ed is our manager, and she manages the staff in the server. We have, you know, admins and moderators, and it's entirely fan run. You know, the fans have kind of created this server. The content you see in the server, we have like an art page, the banner, all that's mostly created by our fans. And it's given us a platform to kind of talk to people in mass numbers now. For example, we hosted an event a few months ago for Pride, and we brought some of our talent into the Discord server to have live Q&As, to, you know, just have discussions about whatever the brand stands for or is passionate about. So we can use it as a platform also, as not just an inspiration, source.
Yeah, and I'm going to say, you guys also like have really like tapped into the gaming culture. So especially on the Skittles brand side of it, I feel like it's like each brand has its own like personality. Like M&M's does like, you know, the rooms on Twitter, like where they have audio rooms, which I think is really cool.
We did tap into that, yeah.
I mean, that's kind of interesting. And then, you know, Skittles is doing like this real gamer kind of vibe. I think they all have very distinct brands. I was actually trying to look for, and I think it's on the TikTok, I was trying to look for it right now, some user generated content that is like all around Minecraft, you know, so like mining Skittles and, I think that was on TikTok. I don't have it.
It was. Yeah. And that actually started with the fans. So, you know, by listening to our fans, what do they like to do? It became obvious pretty quickly. Like a lot of our fans are really into Minecraft. Okay. Maybe we should get into Minecraft too and understand what this all is about. Mm-hmm. And, you know, half our Twitter community now is built of Minecraft fans that follow influential Minecraft streamers. So then one of the things that we started doing is, well, we start playing with our fans. So, you know, we have our Twitch channel, and we can jump on, pull fans in, play Minecraft Among Us. We've done some Valorant streams. So, you know, we can actually engage with them in things that they enjoy doing, anytime.
No, I think it's amazing. So I think that in and of itself is a really thing. And also you're sponsoring other things too. So I was trying to find the Twitter one, but, the Skittles on Twitter, but you guys are also sponsoring like the chess games. I'm sorry, the POG, what is it called? POG Champs? Is that happening?
We do have some sponsorships.
Is that irreverent? See, I never
get a lot of it. A lot of it actually, it comes across a sponsor. A lot of it's actually just organic conversation. So we've actually, you know, reached out to the Among Us team, and we've reached out to Xbox, and we've had conversations organically, and, you know, through back conversations, we've been able to leverage each other's IPs and grow organic conversations. Something does come across sometimes. It's probably a formal sponsorship. When in fact, it's just us kind of having conversations with other brands and engaging with them. Yeah.
You said the official candy of pop.
Okay. So there's a story behind the bio there, but yeah. Okay. So we had a bio that we were told was very like cringy, like an adult wrote it. So there's a whole YouTube video about how bad our bio was. So we had one of our influencers rewrite it for us. So this is the rewritten bio by one of the influencers, trying to make us a bit more relevant. I think it's very sarcastic.
Well, and I just look at this. I mean, but these are the kinds of things we're. It was easy for me to find here, but yeah. You know, just all of these things that you're putting together that are looking very much like what you'd find on TikTok or what you'd find in organically in the platform. So the stuff you guys are making are that way. And then your fans are also making stuff that is like this, and you're using some of that stuff and sharing it, which I think is just
absolutely
really, really smart and fun.
So. Yeah, if you type Skittles on TikTok right now, 90% of the content is not even from us. It's just fans pulling themselves into content. Yeah, be careful. You don't know what's going to come up. But
yeah, I know their stuff. I've seen all kinds of stuff.
All of this is all fan created. You know, it's the one of compressing Skittles in a compressor. You know, who would have thought to do that? It's fascinating.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Let's see, you
know what's going to happen.
You might be able to hear it. I don't know. Oh gosh, it's going to ask me to allow. No, I'm blocking you, TikTok. I'm sorry. No, it's not giving me that. So I'm going to just pull this back up. It doesn't like that. But anyway, so yeah, I mean, now it's going to do it.
There it goes.
I know. I'm turning it off though. But anyway, so the point is there's just a ton of content out there, and people are making content around your brand, and you're interacting with them. And that's really why we're here, is to talk about the humanization of the brand, because I feel that's another thing that you do well. The content is on point. Yes. I mean, I think that's number one. You have to have content that's on point, right?
Yep, absolutely. You got to make sure that it's something people are going to want to interact with.
Right. So you have a team. So let's finish talking about that, because I want to move on from that before we get there, because it's kind of cool what you guys have done. You've done this internal agency idea. So could you talk a little bit about how you do that?
Yeah. So about 3 years ago, you know, I think one of the great things about working for a private company is, you know, we can test things out. And this is just a perfect example of something that came about because, you know, we have this freedom principle. Let's just try doing things ourselves. So we have about like 15 probably brands in the US across Mars mm-hmm. Wrigley on social media. And they were all managed by different agencies and different social agencies. Some are PR agencies, some are creative agencies. And we said, you know what, let's try to rein this in and see if we can kind of bring this ourselves. You know, because I think one of the critical things about this space is moving with speed. You got to be quick. You know, you can't sit on a tweet for an hour. If something is going to happen, you're going to tweet it now. And when you're working with a process and a system that's outside your own control, outside your company, and you have to go through layers of approval, you know, should we tweet this? Let's ask the brand team, then raise it up to corporate affairs and have legal look at it. You're not going to get anything done that way. So by bringing things in-house, we've been able just to kind of move with speed, because all the folks managing this are Mars associates. You know, we're trained in trademark law, in legal, in our marketing code, what we can and can't do. So we're just able to move much quicker by bringing this in-house. And the way that we've set it up is, you know, we have a team of content creators now in-house. You know, probably half my team is just physical content creators, people that are illustrators, designers, animators, and they're just cranking out content. And the beauty of social is you can do that now. You can create content on your iPhone, and it does just as well as if you shot, you know, a $4 million ad in Hollywood. I mean, when you put it up side by side, if it's engaging and it's funny and fans like it, it's going to have the same impact sometimes. So we really
not that you guys don't do Hollywood.
Oh, absolutely. We do a ton of big productions, and we have to. You know, we still have a massive TV campaign, and when we're launching something big, we want it to be amazing. So we still obviously know our creative agencies, BBDO and DDB, do an amazing job of bringing our brands to life for the big productions. But for the everyday organic stuff, where we're not putting paid money behind, you know, we can just be more in the moment, more relevant by just cranking stuff out. You know, every hour, if something's happening, well, we're going to create content and put it out there, hopefully within the same day that's happening in the world, so that we can be really, really real time. And that in-house model has allowed us to kind of do that organically.
No, I think it's amazing because, and that's the thing I've noticed too, is how quick you are with all of it. So how are you managing all of that? Like, I mean, what we always ask about the tools. What tools are you using to manage all this? Because it's a lot to keep your finger on.
Yeah, I mean, the only real tools that we're using were some social listening tools to kind of help us understand our brands spiking in conversation. You know, if there's too many mentions of Skittles one day, let's find out why that's happening. Usually it's a good thing. Sometimes it's not. You know, sometimes maybe we're tagged in some inappropriate material and that's been trending and we don't want to be part of that. So it's good to know kind of where our brands are being talked about every day. So we're constantly monitoring that through some social listening tools. But outside of that, I mean, most of our tools are more content creation tools and designing tools.
What is your social listening tool, if you don't mind me asking? Is it something
We are using, there's a few that we use across the Mars organization, Social Studios, Crimson Hexagon, Meltwater are a few that we're using right now, different teams within Mars. We have our internal research team that uses social listening for other purposes outside of social media. So we have a couple of tools that we can tap into.
So you said Crimson Hexagon.
Crimson Hexagon, and then Meltwater is one that we're using on my team, just because it's a very quick and efficient tool to kind of just get some quick reads on where our brands are trending and sentiment-wise.
And let's go back to the Hubba Bubba one, because I think that was interesting. So was this week even that Hubba Bubba started trending?
It was this week. Yeah.
And on TikTok.
It was on TikTok. In fact, it's funny now because we have this kind of really avid fan base just kind of watches out for us. If something's happening, I mentioned social studios, social listening, but our fans are way quicker than any social listening tool we have. If something's happening, I'll get a few DMs from fans saying, hey, check this out. So last night, one of our fans DM'd me on Twitter, said, hey, Hubba Bubba was being tagged a lot. You should check that out. And I did. And I was like, there actually is, an influencer tagging Hubba Bubba, and his fan base is tagging us like crazy because, you know, he wants to create this giant ball of gum. I hadn't logged into the TikTok account on Hubba Bubba for a few weeks. There's nothing going on. Our fans are the ones that kind of help us kind of find things that are happening in the world around our
brand. That's an opportunity, right? I mean, I don't know if you're going to take it, but what's the opportunity there just to engage?
It's to engage. Without even doing anything, his followers start following us. Well, what if the brand now actually starts to engage back? You know, let's send him some gum. Let's help him fulfill his dream of creating the world's largest ball of gum. Why not? It's just more awareness for us, more awareness for him. He got the brand to notice him, so it's great for him and his fans that are now cheering that Hubba Bubba noticed it. So I think we kind of feed off each other.
No, I think that's great because I think it's a really good example of how to build a fan base. And you do have some great fan bases around the different brands that you have. I love that you have that there's, you don't, I mean, you have stands. I mean, gosh, you have like Skittles stands.
I see some of them here.
I know some of them are here. But I'm just going to say, if you don't know what a stand is, because I know a lot of us are old, let me get my cane. Let grandma get her cane. That a stan is somebody that really loves a brand. They're like, I don't know. You do the thing. Is that what you'd say it is? A stan is somebody who's like,
yeah, it's a fan, a super fan, someone super that, fan.
So if you didn't know what a stan was, that's what it means. But yeah. You have a bunch of, I only know that because I've got teenagers. So they talk about the stans all the time. but yeah, so I think that's really cool because that's something like, so usually people don't interact like that with like a logo or a brand. So, it's not like you're like Mike's face is on the Skittles brand or whoever's, talking at that moment or whatever. Yeah. So how do you kind of get that brand personality? Cause they're all different personalities. How do you get those brand personalities to kind of shine?
I think the first thing we got to figure out is what conversations do we want to be a part of? What do we want to associate ourselves with? And how do we kind of engage in those conversations? I think 3 or 4 years ago, when we were first starting our social media journey, we just used it to push out ads. Oh, we got to talk to, this is a great, people are here. Let's talk to them here. We just pushed out ads and no one's going to watch an ad organically if they can scroll through the timeline. So we realized, okay, we got to start making content that people want to engage with. And that content can't be an ad. So we need to find other ways to talk to people. And, Skittles is lucky in that it has this great personality. Skittles' personality just works so well on social. It's kind of this quirky,
really
unpredictable. Someone described it as this kind of chaotic energy. Like Skittles goes out there strong. Skittles has very strong opinions on things with nothing to back up those rationale for those opinions. They just love to interact and get attention, essentially.
However they can.
And sometimes, you know, they don't always make the best decisions. Sometimes you got to rein Skittles in and like, okay, maybe don't do that. But because of that, they're able to kind of just build an audience. And what's Skittles going to say today? What are they going to do next? And then the best part is they respond. You know, when we look through our DMs, one of the most frequent questions we get is, do you respond? Or I heard Skittles responds. So the more you respond, the more word gets out. This is not just, you know, a company out there, a brand out there. It's, you know, it's a personality. And I think the brands that do it really well actually are thought of as influencers themselves. You know, people treat these brands the same way they would treat, you know, their favorite Minecraft streamer or their favorite influencer, because there's a personality behind it and they get something back from it. The brand kind of learns from them, but also engages back. You know, people also like the clout of having, you know, a Skittles follow or a Skittles response. And, you know, when you respond to someone, cool, they screenshot it, it goes on their Instagram stories. Oh my God, Skittles followed me or Skittles wrote back to me. So you have that aspect of it too. But it's constantly doing that. It's just every,
and building, it's an every on day it, like building, and building on it. And then like they start talking to each other and it kind of
they
just
do.
Becomes, yeah, this, I mean, I've been a part of it, so I kind of seen it
happen. Yeah. And there's ongoing and there's storylines now built, and there's like lore behind what Skittles' history is, and conversations that go awry will become part of who Skittles is, and that storyline carries over to the next tweet. So, you know, people just joining for the first time might not understand some of the tweets, but people that have been with us, what does that mean? Why would you?
I've seen people actually say that. What does that even mean?
Which is even funnier because Skittles is all about being quirky and unpredictable. So if you don't get it, great, keep following us, and you'll get it eventually.
Yeah, you'll get in on the storyline, but. It's I love that you say it has lore. Again, that's a gamer thing, right? So lore is really, really big deal in the gamer community. So the fact that you know that is like really, really important. And I'm gonna pull back up Thor there. So you're pro gamer, and I think that's right. And I love how that, you know, that lore is building, and eventually you're gonna have to have, you know, a creator do an entire like background and film thing on your lore. That would be fun. Especially in the Discord servers, then that would go everywhere.
We were saying we want like a Skittles Wikipedia, a wiki. So like there's a whole article about Skittles and all the characters that Skittles interacts with. Yeah.
Okay. So if you are listening, they need a Wikipedia article. They can't make it themselves. So somebody Skittles go make wiki, a Wikipedia. Yeah. You have a few stands here. Make it happen, guys.
There's even like Skittles fan fiction. Like there's a Wattpad we were watching. There's like fan fiction popping up between Skittles and other fans. It's crazy. Environment.
it's gonna be interesting. And I pulled up what you said about the lovely voice on Twitch, Thor. So again, these are like specialized channels. So Discord, Twitch. Now I'm gonna be honest, Discord and Twitch and some of these are becoming a little bit more mainstream. You could easily put together a really cool community on Discord that rivals something you'd put on like a Facebook group. Right.
Yeah,
it's similar
absolutely.
To a Facebook group, and absolutely. It's really, really powerful. And if you can get people to come onto it. Right. So I think it's like a tool that will go a little bit more mainstream.
Absolutely. I mean, we're seeing other brands join now as well. I think Skittles was probably one of the first, but we're seeing some really great Discord servers pop up from other brands. Ocean Spray launched one recently. Wendy's has an amazing one right now. So they're popping up pretty quickly.
So it's not just for gamers.
It's not just for gamers. I think it did start as kind of a gaming platform for ways that gamers communicate, but now it's expanded to everything. I mean, NFTs are huge on Discord right now. And then every community.
If you wonder what an NFT is. Sorry, I've got to like define.
Yeah. But any community has a passion around something, it's probably has a Discord server now as well. Just like I said, like Facebook groups were, you know, maybe a few years ago, now it's kind of migrating to Discord where you have these live conversations. It's easier to probably to share files back and forth. Have voice chat is a big part of Discord. You can create voice chat rooms where you can actually talk to your fans or have them talk to each other. And you know, once it's built, it kind of sustains itself. The fans are so protective of what happens in that server that we let them moderate it, and we have a lot of faith in what they're doing. They keep it safe, they keep the chat safe, they keep the images, bad images out. So they do a good job of just keeping it, you know, a family-friendly environment.
This is important too, Thor.
Universities, yes.
Universities. So I do think it's, and it's because of this upcoming generation I know my daughter is in it. She's always, I mean, that's, I actually have Discord on my computer so that I can talk to my kids. I mean,
yeah.
You know, just the way you text, I text to my kids that way. That's where they hang out. So that is really, I think, for the people that are in our age range, an unknown thing. I think people don't realize that that's happening, but I've been in this social media thing for, gosh, I don't even want to tell you how long. I'm a grandma again, I told you. You know, as the new things come up, you see them bubble up. Discord is one that I think is big. So we need to do a Discord, like, social media breakfast at some point.
You should.
People probably won't come because they'll be like, what? Like, oh, no. So I'm kind of slipping it in. I'm educating. We also talked about NFTs, non-fungible tokens. That would be really good for brands. Could you tell everybody what an NFT is?
You know, I'm learning myself at the very moment. So many of our agency partners have come to us with amazing ideas about NFTs. But we haven't entered the space yet.
I'm just saying what it is. We need to define it. So I'll define it. So yeah. Non-fungible token is like basically a piece of artwork that then you sell, and then they have like rights to it. So it's all digital. And you have this thing that is like, you know, a value. It goes along with blockchain and a bunch of other stuff that's a little bit like overwhelming, but I know it's kind of, I just am hearing it everywhere. People are starting to do it. So
yeah.
NFTs are questionable. Yeah, I know. They are but I mean, they are selling them. I mean, you can sell air, I guess, but people do it. I have a couple NFTs that
were. Do you really? I haven't gone in yet.
They gave them to me. They were given to me.
Oh, okay.
Gifted. I'm like, oh, okay. Thank you. I think one of my, I was on a live stream, and he gave me something from that. So, because he has all of his guests onto a thing, and he made them into an NFT. But anyway, okay. I was like, okay, I've got an NFT. So I'm learning again. So yeah, for musicians and artists. Yeah, because that is true. Because I like what you say, Elwayne, because Ashley, because, you know, with streaming and stuff, you know, artists have a harder and harder time. You don't just sell a lot of albums anymore. Like that doesn't happen. So CDs are gone, you know, so I do agree with you that that's a really cool idea. All right. So yes, you do request to join on Discord. Yes. So if you go to Discord, request to join. You may have to answer questions. I don't know if you guys require it.
It's a public server, so you can just type in Skittles mm-hmm. on the homepage and you'll find it. There's like rules you have to agree to, like any mm-hmm. place, like rules of conduct, how to behave in the server. And each server defines their own rules, but you don't have to get a private link or anything. It's a public server to access.
Yeah. Okay, cool. So Geeka is asking something that I think is good. And I was going to ask you this anyway, and you have a good answer anyway. So I'm going to definitely pull this up. But so with that level of influences, what does Mars Wrigley do in terms of social or community outreach? You guys have a lot of things you've done. So let's let you talk.
Yeah, I think it varies by brand. We always start with the brand and what does this brand stand for? And what are some of the causes and things that we want to align ourselves to? So it always starts there. Skittles, for example, is one of the causes is around Skittles pride. You know, we look at the community that follows Skittles mm-hmm. and, you know, sometimes and we see a lot of this on Discord too. It's a fan base that, you know, sometimes feels different, sometimes feels, you know, like they support each other. And, you know, a lot of folks have gravitated towards the server. Who are in the community, and you know that's where we kind of started. We worked with Viacom a few months ago for a Q&A session with a few of the RuPaul Drag Race queens came on, and you know because Skittles was already associated with the Pride space, we were able to do that. Like I wouldn't say any brand just go and do that.
It was just a sudden thing that you started doing.
Wasn't like let's try this. No, we you know for the last 5 or 6 years, you know we've been invested in the space, and a lot of our community is as well. So I felt like it's the right thing to do.
I'm pulling this up on your website too, but you guys also have a foundation. Could you talk about the foundation? I'll pull up the...
Yeah, which one?
The Mars Wrigley Foundation. So you guys do have like, I think your values and stuff, I went through all your values on Mars Wrigley, the big company, and you do have like this whole vibe around social awareness and stuff. So could you talk
about absolutely that a little bit? Yeah, I mean, it's a lot that Mars does, Mars Inc. does, that we don't usually talk about at the brand level. So the brands, like even when you started the conversation, people don't know all the brands under Mars's umbrella, because we promote the brands. We don't usually promote Mars, the parent company. But there's a lot that Mars does for the planet, for the environment. Cocoa sustainability, obviously things that impact your industry, but also things that are outside of our industry that, you know, the Mars family has passion for. You know, better communities, happier smiles is the logo there. And you know, we do invest a lot, especially in the communities that we work with, you know, for cocoa production and procurement. But yeah, there's a lot of information there. Probably, I wouldn't say probably a lot of Mars associates don't always know everything, unless you know they double click on it, because we don't always advertise everything that's going on across the area.
And here's their focus area. Yeah. I can make this like go quicker, but their areas of focus are, well, recycling. That makes a lot of sense given the impact on the environment of the brands themselves.
Yep.
I'm going to be slow here. Sorry. It's loading. So you know how that goes sometimes. Our areas of focus, shared smiles. Yeah. This whole smile thing is interesting. Cocoa growing communities. Yeah. Mint farming villages in India have provided greater opportunities for, that's interesting. Crowd smiles.
Smiles comes up a lot, because when you just think about the brands themselves, it ties back to when people talk about M&Ms or Snickers or Skittles, you know, there is that element of just smiling. It's a positive feeling, you know, remembering your childhood, remembering, you know, I think one of the biggest memories around M&Ms are the red and green M&Ms you'd always see around Christmas time. Like those little things bring back those happy memories. So our brands, you know, definitely are rooted in fun and smiles. We want to kind of carry that through to everything else that we do.
And then you also have the social stuff you were talking about around, you know, the different brands and what their social causes are for each specific brand, which I think is really interesting, and that you guys have the ability to do that. Like what kind of, you know, how do you get permission to do that? Like, is it something that you have to kind of run through legal?
Probably
have to
review. Yeah. From a social perspective or just from a brand perspective? I mean, these are things that, you know, so back in the home office, we have the brand team. So the brand teams ultimately lead the decisions on the strategy of where the brands will go. We're a function of that. So the brand teams will brief us in on what their key objectives are, key priorities are. And our job is to figure out, okay, how do we bring that to life on social in a way that people care about, right? Because I mean, doing it organically is very different than paid. But in terms of aligning ourselves to certain causes, yeah, the brand teams kind of lead that discussion. You know, we do have a lot of corporate affairs, and Mars Inc. gets involved when it comes to the bigger priorities. But the brands lead the strategies individually for each of those brands.
Yeah, that's really good. Got a question for you. Hey, thank you so much for doing this. Obviously, you have a stellar brand of products that can be used in social. Do you have any advice on branding interacting for services? So for like, what do you mean by that, Michael, like services, like what we do?
Just making like, sure. like non-CPG products.
Like, I got it. Okay.
I'm assuming
I knew this. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So I think the first thing is, any brand, regardless of what you're selling. So before I worked at Mars many, many years ago, I was managing household cleaning products, right? Very different type of product. They're functional. You know, it was all about claims,
don't
marketing.
Don't
eat them, but this cleans better than this. So you don't have a very social voice. But what you can do is you still have a social voice. Even if your brand is functional and maybe it's not as fun as a candy product, you still have to come across with the personality and in the voice. So I think every brand is a personality. Every brand is a voice. And that's what comes through on social. And I think that's how we've been able to slowly build an audience, is by using that voice and engaging back, and not using social to advertise to people every day, but using social to kind of just talk to people every day, listen to people. Social is a big way to also put out consumer complaints. You know, we respond to every complaint you see. Talk back to people. Don't let anything fester on social. If it's a consumer complaint, acknowledge it, tap into it, and fix it. So that we do have a team on my team. Part of my team is community managers, and their job is just to kind of be on all day and put out the fires. If someone had a bad experience with our product, we want to fix that. And their job is to make sure that everyone is having good experiences, answering questions. You know, our Snickers halal sort of all the questions you get every day. Be there to answer those questions as quick as you can.
Yeah. So, Anna's just agreeing with you. Cause B2B, I mean, that's really the key, you know, is that, it is something that people say like, oh, hey, you've got this really fun brand. It is fun. It's fun. It's something to talk about. You have a prop, but, I love the guy who is smashing your, Skittles. Like it's unfortunately we couldn't watch it, but that thing that he was smashing it with is a hydraulic, you know,
press.
So like that's probably his brand, right? And so you have like this hydraulic press that doesn't seem like it'd be all that interesting, but it is when you start mushing.
You can make it fun.
You can. and then you can also, you know, interact with other brands that are maybe more fun. And believe me, if you can come up with something to do with Skittles, Skittles will react, will work with you.
Yeah. I mean, look at the insurance industry. There's a lot of insurance companies and, you know, that's a boring product itself, but they've made it fun with the voices they've created for their, you know, like Geico and all those guys. They have a fun campaign that could translate very easily to social, and it does translate very well to social. In fact, we interact with some of them occasionally.
Yeah, so definitely. And I do like that you interact even with the complaints, because I think that's really important. Actually, this is my community management person.
Cut the fire right away. Yeah.
She does all of our community management, and it is not easy for a hospital system.
Yeah, it is not. Yeah.
For a hospital system.
Even, and this was something we were told, don't ever do this. We started doing it. Interacting with competitors. You know, we have a very frenemy relationship with Sour Patch Kids. You know, they're not a Mars product. They directly compete with Skittles, but there's these great engagements between Sour Patch Kids and Skittles all the time. And you can kind of see the tension between the two brands. They're always kind of ragging on each other, but it helps both of us. It just drives awareness for both of us. And tapping into topics that are controversial, like Lime Skittles is a big one, right? So was it 10 years ago? Yeah, Skittles replaced Lime with Green Apple 7 years ago. And it was a huge source of complaints. Everyone on Twitter was like, why'd you do this? And you know, the first thing when we started doing Skittles on social, the brand team's like, don't mention it. Don't talk about it. Mm-hmm. We're just gonna move on. Yeah. The first thing we did is we talked about it. We mentioned it. We started, you know, poking people, saying, "Oh, you know, we really had fun with the conversation," and it became this huge meme. And it's been a huge source of content for us because, you know, we're kind of making fun that Lime's no longer with us and Green Apples.
You just put some content out about that. Like, is this Lime or Green Apple?
Yeah, and we're teasing the possible return maybe of Lime. So, you know, we're having fun with that. Yeah. But conversations really help drive the engagement, even if there are conversations that, you know, might not seem like the best thing for the brand to engage with. Sometimes they are.
So she says, don't hate me. I love Sour Patch Kids. That's funny. Okay. That's okay. I don't know. I'm Team Skittles, truly. I don't know, they're too sour for me. But anyway, so that's me. But a couple of things they're bringing up, which is not you, I know, but Geico is a great example of brand personality. How fun or sexy is insurance? It's really good. And love that. KFC, how they took on the chicken fillet sandwich with one line tweet. That was really good too. I love all this, guys. Just keep them coming. We're just having a conversation here. Love it.
The other one we came across was a Duolingo, that the language service. You would think, okay, that's a service. It's probably not very fun, you know, education.
They're mean.
But they're mean, and their TikTok channel is hysterical. They use their mascot just doing all these crazy things. So yeah, you can absolutely have fun with a non-fun
product. Yeah, and their voice isn't like, I mean, it's fun, but it's not mean, but it's like, they're kind of really, they get on you for not doing your, you know, your dual.
Oh yeah,
they do it in the app too. They do it in the app as well.
It's their voice, right?
Yeah.
So and that's the other thing, it carries through. Your social voice should carry through your brand touch points, and not just on social. Look at Skittles packaging, look at the ads. It should be a consistent voice across all consumer touch points. Mm-hmm. Social is the one place you have to kind of play it out a bit more. You can be a bit more real time and blow it out a bit more. So you're a bit more freedom there.
No, I love it. And you know, that talky sort of thing. So that's the other part that I think is really important, that even though you're this big brand, you have legal, you have all these constraints, people don't realize at the corporate level, the kinds of constraints that a corporation usually has. And so you guys have been able to streamline that into a very quick, and I give you all credit for putting this brand, you know, kind of tag team together that just goes out and, like, you know, quickly in real time handles all of the stuff. So that to me is like really, really something that most brands haven't nailed. I mean, it may be for one brand, but it's been hard for most brands to nail that. So good.
Yeah, I mean, and there's also, there's a lot of behind the scenes regulatory stuff too that, we follow. I mean, one of the biggest things that, we hold ourselves to very truly is our marketing code. You know, we are a candy company. We do not want to market to children. You know, we market to the gatekeepers, the parents who manage what children can eat. So, you know, we never advertise in spaces that has children 13 or under in the majority. So all of our media buys are done 13 older. All of our content has to be sure, we have to, every piece of content we create, we have to make sure this is going to appeal too much to children, because we don't want it to appeal to children. Think about M&Ms. You have these characters where you would think, well, they're characters, they're for children. But no, look at the situations they're in. We never put our M&Ms characters in situations that's going to appeal for children. We put them in adult situations, everyday situations. So things like that, you would think there's a lot of great creative ideas. A lot of them get killed because we think it's probably leaning too much into the child space. So we hold back a lot in what we
want. Well, and I appreciate you doing that, because even though you say you don't do 13 and older spaces, I mean, everybody knows that there's a lot of 13 and under people on the 13 and older spaces. Because, you know, COPA, which is the Child Protection Act in the United States, requires like Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram, TikTok. None of them are supposed to have any kids under the age of 13, but we all know that they're there. So they lie about
you can tell. Yeah.
So I mean, it's a universal problem. So I love that you're saying that you guys actually look at, you know, really focusing on the parents. That's really great.
Yeah.
I like the red M&M about to be eaten ad. That's a good one.
That's right. Yeah. We've eaten some of them a few times in the ads.
Yeah. And then, and that's the other thing that you guys have done. I want to talk about that a little bit, is that personalizing experiences. So my M&Ms is maybe a good example of that, but personalizing experiences for your fans. Could you talk about that?
Yeah, I mean, that's probably our biggest online business, is the customized M&Ms where you can print your own, you can print your own face now on an M&Ms lentil. So custom colors, custom images. So that's really big. But when it comes to social content, that's part of what makes engagement so fun, is you're personalizing your responses to everyone. So anyone that gets a tweet from Skittles or from Snickers or M&Ms, it's probably going to be personalized. One of the things I tell my team is, don't just respond to people. Don't just do a thumbs up and a like. Mm-hmm. Actually read what they wrote. Click on their profile. See what they're about. Say something that you know is going to make them know that you know a little bit about them. We try to personalize the responses to make sure that it's not just, you know, a blanket response, a form response that every brand gives out. To make it a bit more meaningful.
Well, I think that's good too, because I mean, you also get into people's lives. Like, they feel like Skittles knows me, or, you know, M&M's knows me or whatever. And that's sort of how you and I met in some ways, just being through these kinds of interactions. So I think kind of crazy.
Did you meet Skittles first or me? I don't know who you met first.
Well, you. So you I don't think we were on a chat, or I don't remember. By the way, I have to remember, but you know, I have to, like, through this, you might get a lot of other appearances. Sorry. A lot of people are like, well, I'll do this. I'm like, I don't know. You have to say, I don't know. So I will be interviewing a few people, but the key was that I liked the voice that you had. I watched you interacting with Skittles. Because that's the other kind of interesting thing that happens, is that you are interacting with the brands as you, which is really interesting. I've never seen that. So
as Mike.
Yeah. As Mike.
Probably by accident. I think I forget exactly when somehow I was revealed to be in charge or the voice of some of these brands. And I think then I started getting tagged in things. And I'm in the Discord server as you know, one of the managers and admins. So I think people started realizing, okay, I think he's more than just, you know,
a pretty thing.
He might have a little influence with the brands. And then, you know, I think it's fun when the brands do interact with each other, and then I'll come in and kind of pull them apart. But yeah, it's just, you know, the fans that know kind of enjoy just seeing the conversations play out. Some of them have called me out for talking to myself between myself and Skittles. Like, Mike's just talking to himself on TV. But
not always.
No, and there are plenty of times when it's not really me behind the Skittles account.
You just aren't able to do it. Like, I mean,
I can jump in if I see something.
Channels, you have access.
If I see something in real time that I think is worth jumping on, I'll just jump on. But the team does an amazing job of just kind of being real time and conversational.
I just love how they talk about you being their boss, though. I just think that's really fun. You know what
they're like my children.
Yeah, they're like your children, and you like scold them, and they're like. I don't know. It's a really fun vibe, and I think it's probably why some of your fans like it. So
it's really Skittles that we have to rein in. Skittles is a little troublemaker sometimes.
Yeah. Well, Skittles is hilarious. So, you know, yeah. Very much a cat herding experience in my opinion. Yeah, the tweets are hilarious. I agree. So that's the good thing. I mean, there's just a lot of humor. It's a lot of fun. It's just, if you want to go hang out on Twitter and talk to Skittles, Skittles will talk to you. So
yeah, it's fun.
Yeah. So, I mean, and that's, I think that's, let me just kind of back up for one second. That's really important in the world we're in because, you know, a lot of people go onto social media and they get no response from anybody. Like, and it feels overwhelming and sad. And, you know, that's why they talk about people being depressed because they don't get enough likes. They don't have anybody that interacts with them. So, I mean, the fact that the brands are interacting with people, like real people in real time, I think that's really powerful because you are, you're helping with mental health. You're helping with, you know, people's excitement in life. And so, and the smiles, which is your value.
It's by far the best part of this job is just seeing reactions from people of knowing you just made someone happy, made someone laugh. And you see it every day. So that was an unexpected surprise moving into this role and this and doing this kind of thing for my role. Now, it never thought that, you know, you could bring happiness to someone like that. My old role, I worked in brand management for so long. And as a marketer, you know, you're creating all this content and you push it out, but you don't actually take it to the next level of now seeing how people respond to it and getting to talk to them. Now, when you're in marketing, the only time you get to talk to your consumers is like in a focus group setting. There's like a sheet of glass in front of you. And you have to like, you know, you're just kind of slipping notes to a moderator. But I encourage all the marketers and the brand teams to like come into the social media studio occasionally, jump on the account, talk to your fans directly, jump in a private group chat and really get to know them. Like I never got to know our consumers the way that I do now after doing this for 3 years. You know, I had 10 years of brand experience. You get charts and reports around what your consumer is, who they are. It's good to have that, but you really experience it in a setting like this where you can talk to them every day.
That changes what content you create too, doesn't it?
Absolutely. A lot of the content, like we get briefed by the brand teams to create X, Y, and Z. And we're like, okay, maybe, but let's do this instead because we know this is going to do better from our fans and we'll figure out how to work the marketing objectives into our content. But not every piece of content is going to ladder up to an immediate marketing objective because you have to build a relationship. And, you know, look at, like you mentioned Skittles Twitter, look at half our tweets have nothing to do with Skittles at all because we're trying to build a relationship and build a personality. And we can sprinkle in, you know, the brand objectives throughout that, you know, the time.
Well, usually your fans bring that in. So like, you know, they do. They may go, there's a ton of Skittles gifts. I'm going to tell you, I had no problem finding Skittles gifts out there. To share back to the brand.
And they're all fan made probably, most of them. They
totally are. I mean, you know, on Giphy or something. I don't know. It's crazy. So it's just a lot of really, but that is like a virtuous circle is or what I like to call a virtuous circle where you're like feeding into the fans. They're feeding back to you. You're interacting with their stuff. They're like excited. So they make more stuff.
Yeah. And it's funny, I would say our fans probably talk more about Skittles than Skittles talks about Skittles now, because you're right. They're the ones that bring it back to the product and we're kind of just talking about anything and the fans then bring product into it. So it's great to have that.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome. So let me see, let me make sure I cover all the things we said we would cover. I kind of went all over the place. I did a Skittles thing. I didn't go down through our thing in order, sorry. Yeah, bringing your content in-house, expanding to new platforms. Twitch was on there too. So I had Twitch to talk about. So can we talk about Twitch for a minute? Because we've hit on it, but we haven't talked about it. So talk about what you do on Twitch.
Twitch was taking it to the next level. It's actually now playing with our fans. You can talk to them, you can tweet to them, but let's actually get them into a room and actually, you know, compete with them. So, you know, games like Among Us are fun games, but you can actually play with 20 people now. So I can get 19 fans and Skittles into a match of Among Us and stream it live. So everyone's watching the 19 lucky fans that are playing with Skittles get to experience that. And then we can rotate new fans in every match. So it's just a whole nother way of interacting with your fan base. And granted, yeah, it's very small scale. You only have so many people playing Skittles at one time, but you do it enough times and you start to build up now, you know, I think we have like 15,000 followers on our Skittles Twitch channel. I've seen the chat here, you know, Minecraft, same way, Fortnite. We've been streaming Fortnite occasionally and play that with our fans. So there's just lots of, I've seen Mike is bad at Among Us. Thank you.
Mike is bad, yeah. So
even Thor here, I see Thor. So Thor does an amazing job just creating Minecraft maps. And that's how he met Thor. So he's a Minecraft map creator, and you know he's working on a Skittles map right now. So like he's
super cool.
A prime example of creating with our brand, but in the gaming space.
No, and I love that because I mean it's just like you go where the fans are, and I think that's really important. Even if you are bad at Among Us, you're there. You're working on it. You're trying. I can't imagine your mining skills in Minecraft.
My Minecraft skills are not good. When you see what these people can do, when you see like what these guys can do, I can't do anything good to them.
I mean, are you Dream?
What's that?
Are you Dream?
Am I Dream? I'm not Dream. No.
Okay,
I think he follows us now, but no.
Okay, cool. Dream is a very, very famous.
He's a very big Minecraft.
Yeah. So anyway, nobody knows who he is. So I had to ask you if you were Dream.
No, it's not me.
Okay. Cool to know. Just making sure we're moving on. So building social engagement and brand fan base. Again, how can people, let's bring it back to like every day. I think we've talked about in engaging with people, even if they're not your fans. By the way, you can start with like not having any followers and just be an engager, and that will get you followers. Is that true?
Yeah. I think if you're witty and funny and clever, but you're chiming in other people's conversations, that's going to get you noticed. Absolutely.
Yeah. Hey, you know, that's how I got you here in the seat. So we'll get there. I'm not saying I'm witty, charming, and funny, but I tried hard. So there's that. There's building social engagement on channels. So you're across a bunch of different channels. But again, I love how some of your brands aren't engaging on all the channels. So talking about really like focusing on the ones that you can really do well.
Yeah, I'm saying not all brands have the right personality for every social media platform. I think, for example, Dove chocolate. It's a more of a premium chocolate, and it probably has a bigger Instagram presence than other.
I was gonna say it looks lovely
because it's more visual, right? You know, these beautiful recipes and these beautiful chocolate shots. It doesn't really have a Twitter voice. We tweet, you know, we definitely do, but it doesn't have like the sass that Skittles has. So we tend to regulate Dove more to the visual channels versus the conversational channels. Each brand has their own way in.
Dove could be like the love channel, like, you know, I love
exactly, yeah, exactly.
Loving you and doing
the indulgent,
just beautiful and like kindness, you know, like, yeah. Oh, just here to make you feel better. I think Dove could do that.
Yeah.
Super cool. So having a voice is really important. So how did you like develop voice for these things?
So this probably goes back more to the brand strategy and the brand compass. So every brand has an existing kind of compass and where the brand should play, how the brand should come across. Most brands have a predetermined voice before social media even was a thing, right? These brands are 30, 40, 50 years old. So we kind of had a voice for the brand, how it shows up on TV and print ads. We took that voice that already existed for these brands like Skittles and M&M's, and we adapted it to how would this voice come across in an everyday environment. Because when you think about it, when I'm writing a TV commercial for Skittles or M&M's, I need to do that once or twice a year. So I can be really, you know, you spend a lot of time perfecting that thing. When I'm giving a voice to Skittles on Twitter, I'm doing that a couple of times a minute. So you can't overanalyze every word or every inflection of every you know thing you do. You got to kind of just almost be on the fly responding. So it requires a little bit of adapting what you have on TV and applying it to social. Mm-hmm. And the best way we do that is by assigning kind of a character to our brands. What's a celebrity or a fictional character that you can kind of have represent this brand, and how would that character engage in the situation? So it gives you a little bit of a guideline and guidance to kind of put a voice to it.
Novelist to do this.
Yeah, and in fact, we look from when we hire people who are gonna be actively on Twitter, we want people that obviously one can write really well, or creative writers, have a little bit of wit to them that can be fast thinkers and be funny on the fly. You know, a lot of people that are good at strategy, maybe not are always good at creative writing. So it's hard to find, you know, our strategists that we have are not just strategists, but they're really funny writers too. So you kind of got to find people that can do a little bit of both.
Mm-hmm. No, that's great. I mean, and I think having those characters like clearly, it's not so much an avatar, which I mean, I know a lot of people talk about having an avatar. I like how you talked about it being a character. Of that has a story. I just think that's really, really powerful there.
Yeah.
So
It's like writing for a character, I would imagine. If you were writing a character in a movie or a show, like that's the voice you got to come up with for your brand voice.
Uh-huh. Yeah, cool. Anne's gonna go follow Dev on IG.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, so it is pretty. I was looking at all the different. I kind of fell into a rabbit hole going down all the different channels you guys had from the website. I was just like, wow, I had to stop. It was really late last night, and I was thinking, I better go to bed so I'll get up in time for the interview. But it was fun. I mean, it was fun to see the different ways that you do it and how you can bring together different brands and bring it together. So how can you mix things? I've also heard that from you. I'd love if you guys have any other questions to dump them in right now, because we're kind of coming up to the time. We're at the hour. So I might could take one more if you do it quick. But in the end of the day, the key is that you need to have a personality on social media. That's why I brought you here.
Yep. So you do. Absolutely. So,
how did you develop your personality? What did your mom say?
My personality? Mm-hmm. My Italia or the brand?
No, I'm just talking about you in general. You're very funny. So I'm just saying, what's your background?
I know what it is. I love doing it. And that's critical. I mean, they always say you got to like, and you got to enjoy what you do in life. You got to enjoy your job. If I didn't enjoy doing this, I would not be funny. You know, well, my tweets would bomb, but I think I really genuinely enjoy doing this. And that just, you know, it's funny, because a lot of Skittles passions are my own personal passions. So it's easy to become a character when you kind of have similar passions and you think similar ways. So I think it comes down to just really enjoying doing this. And then, you know, you put a lot of passion and work into it.
Anne says, which personality are you talking about, Cam? he might need a psychiatrist. Because
I do jump around. I do make mistakes. I do actually, we have had a few times where I've tweeted from the wrong account with the wrong voice, or sometimes I've tweeted thinking it was me and it wasn't. It's fine. I'm still here.
And Thor says, you know, enthusiasm is contagious, which shows in Skittle socials. It does. And so
thank you.
I love it. So yeah. So thank you, Ingrid says, and I'm going to say it too. Thank you so much for taking time out of your extremely busy schedule
Absolutely.
To talk to us here. And again, Absolutely. Guys, I want to remind you, we're going to do a little game. I want you to go around your house and find all of the Mars brands you can find. Here are mine. And then take a picture of yourself with your Mars brands. And then either tweet them, Instagram them, whatever channel you like, you can put them on, you know, it'd be weird to put them on LinkedIn, but you can put them, there's a bunch of people here from LinkedIn. You can put them on LinkedIn, maybe say, I saw this really cool brand thing today, or share our stream from today and say, hey, I went around my house and I found these brands and you can just write them out. I don't know. Just use what works on whatever channel and tag us actually with our hashtag SMBHOU. And I'll put that up here real quick. And then we will interact with you later today. Yeah. So just, put it up. I'd love
to interact. If you're on Twitter, do it, tag the brand too, and the brand will probably respond to you today.
Oh, yeah. The brand might. Yeah.
I might have connections.
Thank you. Well, you know, we might. And I'm going to actually put up the, I didn't do that earlier, but I'm going to put it up right now. I'm going to put up our hashtag so you guys can see it in case you didn't hear me. It's right here. And then I will put it up here. See, I could do it quick. SMBHOU. So definitely do this. I'm terrible at that, the video part of this. So do this. Get all of your Mars brands so we can interact with you. But I do think this is great. So thank you so much for being here. And we will talk to you, all of you out there, next month. We are going to have Beth Cantor. And she came for our gift of guidance last month and talked about, you know, just well-being. She's an author. And she's going to be talking about, she really comes with a nonprofit perspective, but she's going to be talking about AI. So augmented, you know, kind of that kind of reality and how you can use different tools like that in your business and be human. So we're going to stick with the human theme next month. And that's it. So I'll see you soon and talk to you later. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.